I do want to spend a little time on the term soil health because it is showing up in a lot of publications, a lot of things, and I don't want anybody to think that soil health is this thing you can buy on Amazon and now you got it and now you can move forward. You've got your thing and now you can move forward with your soil health and all things will be good. We'll talk a little more about that, but as we look at this system, how it all works together, the beauty of this is the environmental services are fantastic of having this ecosystem working again, but the production potential and the sustainability and how we're going to feed a hungry world is unbelievable, especially when we combine that with some of the technologies that we've got, the genetics, the precision ag stuff. So I talk about building a working conservation cropping system that focuses on soil health to keep us reminded that we still want good production. If we talk about soil health, just to touch on this for a minute, I apologize, I missed the morning session that we canceled yesterday and we've been trying to get here ever since. So I don't know what has already been said, but I think soil health, if you're really going to talk about soil health, it should be more of an adjective, you know, or more of a verb with a lot of adjectives tied to it. And so it's not a thing. It's not a place. It's more of a journey. And it involves the things that we actually do have reams of literature, scientific literature on that to achieve this thing called soil health, we're really talking about increasing organic matter, increasing aggregate stability, increasing water infiltration, increasing water holding capacity, improving nutrient cycling and balancing and diversifying soil biology. A lot of the things that Duane just laid the groundwork for. Really, soil health is just a term that is a term for everything that Duane's been trying to teach for as long as I've known him. So the reality is it's all of these things in a continuum. Because the day that we stop, the day that we think, well, we got it, we now own soil health, we've got it, as soon as we stop, it starts degrading again and we wind up like some of the pictures that Duane showed. So to get there in a cropping system, and this kind of lays the groundwork for what we want to talk about here, is we've got to provide that continuous living root. We've got to first, though, start with minimizing soil disturbance. We've got to maximize the cover, keep the shelter, buffer those temperatures in the hot summertime so that organisms can actually survive, protect it from erosion, and then bring in the biodiversity. And that's in the Midwest, we're just not very diverse. We got corn and beans, you know, corn and beans. That's just not very diverse. It's hard to get that component unless we use the cover crops. The cover crops are how we can start getting some of that diversity back. And so that's why it's so important. And then, of course, that's why how we start getting the continuous living roots. But if we get a farmer starting to think that whatever system he uses or she uses, it needs to have these principles attached to it in mind. They need to be looking at a system that can invoke these four principles. And once they do that, there's going to be several paths to getting improved soil health and soil function, but it would need these principles. Ultimately, what we're after, and it's what we've spent some time already this morning talking about, is the biodiversity is really some of the most important components of this, because what we've got to do in agriculture, we've got to create a greater range of pathways. I work a lot with, you know, the Fertilizer Institute, and they're doing really good things talking about the four R's. The four R's, right place, right time, right form, you know, all of those. That's very important, and it's even more important because in most of Midwest agriculture, most of agriculture in general, we're focused on a single pathway to get those resources to that crop. We're going to try to put the nutrients as close to the roots as we can, as close to the time that the crop needs it in the right form. So we're focused on a single pathway. So it is far more important then to have the four R's if that's your concept. What we're talking about now is adding to that a greater range of pathways, not a single pathway. In other words, the crop doesn't have to get its nutrients out of a tube, a shank, or a coulter, or something like that where we're putting it. We're going to create a multiple range of pathways for it to get at the resources that it truly needs. And we're going to use more of the pathways that the crop plants in general were designed to get the resource. You know, we're going to put back the way that nature intended for them to get their resources through multiple pathways, and that's what the diversity does for us. It ultimately brings resilience to our cropping system from our soil when we're in a terribly erratic climate cycle right now. The rains all come at once. You know, 2 inches of rain's really nice, except that when it comes in 30 minutes and 3/4 of it or 9/10 of it runs off. But if we can get that to now go in the ground and store it there, not just let it go in the ground, but when we look at these degraded soils, even if we get it in the soil, it just keeps right on going because there's nothing to hold it. It just goes right on, and now we've got tile everywhere. So it goes right on out the tile, and then it's gone. And for some reason, in the Gulf of Mexico, they don't appreciate getting all of our nitrogen. We're giving them all this free nitrogen. They don't care about it. So we've got to stop that. But we've got to keep those resources on the farm and get this resilience back to our soil. So even in a corn bean rotation, which is terribly non-diverse, if we can start getting some cover crops integrated back into that system, we can start building some diversity. So, you know, where Dwayne works on a lot of different crops and very complex crop rotations, I'm going to spend most of my time here just looking at that basic corn bean rotation and what's the best maybe we can, where can we start with that, start an improvement with that. We have to look at a conservation cropping system. Dwayne said it, but you can't just say, I'm going to no-till and that fixes everything. Or you look at a research paper and the research paper compares no-till to something else. And it's like, well, what did that no-till look like? Can I go look at it and see? I would like to know whether I would classify it as a quality no-till system, or is that just the absence of tillage? Okay, and so many times that's what it is. So we talk about a quality no-till system, and we invoke a lot of things, controlled traffic and a lot of other mechanisms to make the no-till system work better. But if we're going to do that, then we're undoubtedly going to have to adapt our nutrient management to match that no-till system. Because all the rules that we learned in a lot of our agronomy classes were done under conventional tillage systems. And so they just don't benefit or they don't complement our no-till system. So we're going to adapt that nutrient management system so that it complements the no-till. We're going to look at our crop rotation and we're going to say, okay, within our crop rotation, we have to adapt the nutrients management for it, but then at the same time it has to match our no-till system too. Which crop rotation is going to most benefit the no-till system or vice versa? They all have to start complementing each other. So when we start introducing cover crops, we can't just go pick a cover crop and say that's good. We got to have a strategy. We got to know exactly what it is we're going to benefit from by adding that cover crop. We've got to look at our crop rotation. Certain cover crops work better ahead of corn than behind corn, you know, and ahead of beans and behind beans. So in that corn bean rotation, we got to have a strategy here. And then that cover crop also then is going to change how we manage our nutrients, because early in the spring, these cover crops are out there growing. They have the soluble nutrients in them. They were the first feeder to the trough. So that changes the nutrient cycle and release to our crop. We have to just know that. It's going to be good if we can figure it out and we can plan for it. It's going to be good, but we do have to change timing and change some of the things so that it all complements each other. The good news is we've got precision technology today that, you know, this whole system was a lot harder 20 years ago. I mean, I think I laid out my first set of no-till test plots in 1983 in Shelby County when I was right out of college. Now, I think the local agent just basically said, this young kid will give him a job. He'll go out there and wear himself out. He'll lay out all these plots and give me something to do to burn off energy. But what we found out back then in 1983 was no-till was hard. I mean, it was, you had weed control issues. You had 100 years of tilling the ground. The ground was hard and it was degraded and there was a lot of things that was very difficult, but we have technologies that really help us. The other thing is, when we bring all this together and start truly improving that soil health, we now know, Duane and I were talking about, John Lundgren did some work there at his place that he reported at the no-till conference, that we've got to take a serious look at how we manage pests now. Because now we truly are starting to get some of those beneficials that we've got to take care of. And we've got to change how we manage pests as we look at this overall system. So it all has to fit together so that the benefit of the whole system far outweighs the sum of its parts. You get 4 + 4 = 10 instead of 4 + 4 = 8. And that's how these systems are really working. Good things are happening that we really can't explain. Once we enter the biological realm, there's things happening that we can't explain. A lot of it happens because we're now building organic matter, and we're building that new reactive organic matter, that new carbon that is far more beneficial to us than probably even the old humus that we inherited. The other thing that we're doing, and we have to talk to farmers about, is if we're truly trying to strive to improve that soil health, the first place we start building carbon is pretty close to the soil surface, especially if we're getting these root masses there. So if we're coming in every other year and we're running a field cultivator 4 inches deep and breaking that up, then we never really get this, and we certainly never get this. We certainly never get reactive carbon deep into the soil profile that gives those next cash crops roots a place to go with a path of least resistance, that they're also, as they go deep for water, you know, there's three roots here, there's a bean root, corn root, and an annual ryegrass root, and an earthworm sharing the same channel. Well, you know what an earthworm's doing? That's our livestock that lives underneath the ground. There's a lot of digestion happening there, and really good things coming out the back of that earthworm down deep. So when that corn root goes deep for water, it's not just getting water. It's getting a very, very balanced diet of nutrients, all the nutrients it could ever want, deep into the soil profile in a nice balanced manner. That I think that's some of that equation. You throw in the mycorrhizal benefits that are colonizing all along that rhizosphere, and you've got things happening that we really don't have a lot of literature that fully can explain to us exactly all the good things, but we know that we can grow crops when we ought not be able to. This particular field, I think I've got another slide here, yeah. 10 years of continuous no-till and only 2 years of continuous cover crops in the worst drought on record in 2012. And this field, the farm that was under this system, still averaged 170 bushels per acre corn. No irrigation. Worst drought on record in Indiana, and that was the kind of yield that we had. But look at where the roots are at. That crop really never, ever looked drought-stressed. There was some heat that affected pollination a little bit, but mostly... This was a crop that should not have happened, but it happened because we have this biological activity going. Okay, so when farmers see this, and we dig these pits all over in Indiana in our conservation cropping system, we show them these pits like this, and it's like kids in a candy store. You know, they're down there looking at the roots and seeing this and getting excited, and so they want this. But getting this system functioning from where you were in just a standard old corn bean rotation isn't as intuitive as you might think it would be. So we try to put together a strategy, help start thinking strategy with the help of a lot of our farmers in our CCSI hub farm. But so we start looking at this. This is a pretty narrow for corn bean rotation, but here's a rough strategy I'll go through really quick because I want to get to the farmers. But strategically, If we know our next crop is corn, we know what the number one nutrient that corn crop's going to need is what? We worry about is nitrogen, right? Okay, so if we plant a cereal grain only cover crop, this goes back to what cover crop are you going to use and why. If we just go out there and put wheat or rye as a cover crop and we plant it in the fall, what's the number one nutrient it's going to take up and use? Nitrogen, right? So you got a cereal grain ahead of a corn crop that's wanting the same nutrients. Well, which one was the first feeder to the trough? The wheat or rye was. This is wheat in this case. Okay, so notice this corn, pretty narrow leaf, pretty anemic looking at this point. Because a corn crop, we know through radioisotope studies that corn really only uses about half of the nitrogen we apply. It still, because nature told it to, it gets half of its nutrients from the soil. But if our cover crop was going for the same nutrients, we have somewhat of a bad strategy here. Okay? Now, if erosion control is your number one thing and you've got to have cover, this can work. You just have to still manage it differently. You've got to try to kill that cover crop in a vegetative stage before it gets all that carbon built up, you know, the high C to N ratio. And you've got to have to apply some upfront nitrogen to get this thing off to a good start in corn. Okay, so that you got to change your strategies. But the reality is that cover crop strategy wasn't the best ahead of corn. A better one might be this. Here's corn after what? I have you as a disadvantage because it looks like corn after corn, right? Everybody knows we can't no-till that corn after corn, right? I mean, we can't do that. That's all. That's right. It can't be done because we've been told it can't be done. But the reality is this, it really isn't corn after corn. It's corn after annual ryegrass, crimson clover, and oilseed radish with a little bit of poultry litter put on in the fall with that. Okay, so now we've got a crop that is actually getting the benefit from a low C to N cover crop mix, a high protein mix, just like you're feeding that rumen, you're feeding that cow. Think of corn needing the same thing. So now we've got a corn crop that's really responding from a good strategy cover crop mix ahead of that. So if we can get something like a legume, something high in protein ahead of corn, that's your ultimate strategy if you can make that happen. If you're going to have cereal rye ahead of corn, that potentially has a tremendous high C to N if we let it go to maturity. So we want to kill that more in a vegetative stage. Or let's turn that cereal rye. You can have a little bit of cereal rye, but let's get something else growing with it. This has crimson clover and Austrian winter pea, and actually it had oats and radish that was planted with it in the fall that actually came up quick, scavenged up some extra nitrogen from the previous crop. Then winter killed, released those nutrients to this, converting. It's like we're feeding it. Think about feeding a cow. How would you do that? So now we've got a high protein food source that we're going to plant our cover crop into, or that we're going to plant our corn into. Even though there's still a lot of cereal rye there, as that starts to break down with all those other with the legumes in it, it becomes a cover crop of high protein, and you can see that the corn crop then really responds to that, never really wants for anything, because now you've got the best slow-release nitrogen you can have coming from plants, coming from the soil, and it's going to give it up right when that corn crop needs it the most, okay? So we can utilize that nitrogen. It's going to take less total nitrogen because it's going to come at exactly when we need it from multiple pathways. We're providing the resources from multiple pathways for that crop to get at the resources that it needs. Okay, and then you're going to wind up with a really good crop. Soybeans are totally different. This is actually Dale's plot, one of his organic soybean crops. And you can't see it, but underneath that is cereal rye. So soybeans are different. Soybeans are legumes, so you got a totally different strategy now, right? So is cereal rye ahead of soybeans a problem if it takes up all the nitrogen? Not as much of a problem. Actually, there's some work that shows that soybeans will start nodulating earlier. They'll start making nitrogen, fixing nitrogen earlier in a nitrogen deficient environment. So if we can get those beans to start nodulating earlier, then we've got these beans nodulating earlier. The beans then get the advantage from that extra blanket of what? That moisture, that mulch, the extra moisture from that. The extra weed control, this is organic, right? So you're getting weed control from that mulch as well. But probably more importantly is, what does everybody say how it takes to make a really good bean crop? What do you need in August to make a really good bean crop? You just need a little bit of rain. Well, that thick mulch is your extra rain, because now you've cooled the soil temperature, you've reduced nighttime respiration a lot. So we've got a lot of extra moisture available. We've got an extra half an inch or an extra inch of rain when those beans start getting ready to fill. So really nice strategy to have a cover crop like that ahead of soybeans. So it's a totally different strategy, but it fits into the system. We need a better understanding, and I don't know what happened on this slide. That those were all in a row, but things just happen.
Happened,
you know,
on the airplane.
It just, yeah. It was a rough flight. We had a rough landing. I don't know. You just never know. Yeah. But a head of beans, we're okay up here if we've got the high C to N ratio. But strategically, see, here's this balance. Kind of the soil will seek this balanced diet. So it anything higher than that in C to N of our cover crops, we're going to start tying up nitrogen, immobilizing nitrogen. A little lower than that, it'll actually be more of a source of nitrogen for the next crop. So strategically, a head of corn, you want these. Head of beans, you want this up here. Okay, so that's kind of the strategy. So if we're thinking about that, here in the Midwest, in Indiana, if a farmer was really starting in the ground zero, maybe haven't even been no-tilling, but want that ultimate system, want to head down the road to higher soil function and higher soil health, how would you start them off? And this is just a simple logic model that I've seen work on a lot of corn and bean farms around and works really well. So I always hate to tell somebody how to do it. I figure they'll figure out how to do it if we give them the principles, but there's still some that need help to get over that hump in the first step. So I start them off with the very first, if I was going to start off, one of the first things I'd try to do is get cereal rye after corn. And that's counterintuitive to most people's way of thinking where you would start. I've got my dog Lucy out here because she reminds me that you're changing management and you're changing the environment out there. So you do have to have a really good scout. I mean, you got to make yourself scout because you're going from one whole system totally changing. So you do have to do a really good job in that transition and scout for things. Lucy's good for about 3 or 4 voles per walk around the field. Now, moles are a different story. She carries them back to the yard and releases them because she gets sidetracked. So it's not as good a deal there. But voles she'll eat. So we're going to start with cereal rye after corn. Now, if it's a new system, that biology we're talking about hasn't jump-started yet. So some of these farmers have these vertical tillage tools that they're, you know, they've spent $60,000 on. So we got to let them use it for something. So, right. So they've got that thing and they really want to use it. So I tell them, I said, well, okay, put a seeder on it. It'll have an actual use then. We can seed cover crops with that vertical tillage tool or a drill into those corn stalks. And if we're worried about the corn stalks breaking down, because we don't have that biology in the existing system, then maybe that'll help get you off to a good start. But that's my first no-till operation, essentially, is my cereal rye. Second no-till operation is now comes the soybeans part of this. And the beauty of soybeans into cereal rye is, while this isn't my choice to wait this long necessarily, there's not a significant penalty if it does grow. If it's a wet spring, you can still plant into that without a significant yield penalty. So you can plant soybeans into that, and it comes out pretty good. The thing that I try to tell people is look for in your area a shorter season bean that still yields good that you can plant early. Plant it early. Plant an early bean early. It gets to take advantage of this, all this extra mulch and moisture, and you generally don't give up much yield, or we don't see much yield in our area in West Central Indiana. We don't see much yield loss if going with a shorter bean. So why do I want a shorter bean harvested earlier? I'm building a strategy here, so I want that, yeah, I want that wider window so I can pick from more species in the fall. I got a better choice list that I can use in the fall because as it gets later in the season, species start dropping off that you can actually use. Okay, so that becomes my now second no-till operation. So my third no-till operation, if my beans have come off and that strategy is held true, I'm going to look for a low C to N mix, that high protein mix. So I'm looking at something like oats and radish. If you're a beginner and you're really worried about having all that cover in the spring in the Midwest, a lot of people are really worried that they want that soil to warm up quick in the spring. So they plant an oat radish mix that winter kills, and then they can plant into that. As you get a little further down the line with your confidence, you might go with a mix with one of your precision planters that's got actually oats and radish that winter kill. That becomes like a vegetative strip-till system, and then you can have vetch or Austrian winter pea or a legume that becomes a biological nitrogen side dress operation. Okay, so this is your strategy. This becomes your third no-till operation. Okay, why am I counting no-till operations? You'll see in just a minute, maybe. But this is my third no-till operation. And I'm really starting to build the biology. I'm getting some of that diversity. I'm getting some of those deeper root channels built so that my fourth no-till operation is the crop that everybody in the Midwest worries about is corn. And they're most worried about being able to no-till corn in there because that's the one that they struggle the most with. Well, this corn crop now gets to start into where we've already got good biodiversity, we've got deep roots, we've captured extra nitrogen that's going to be spoon feeding that corn crop through the year, and we fully expect no yield drag whatsoever, your very first corn crop, which is now your fourth no-till operation. Many no-tillers that started years ago says, well, after about the fourth year, it starts transitioning, it starts working, you know. I think we can jumpstart and build the biology faster with these cover crops if we start in and start with the legumes first and then finish with your corn crop. So we expect a very, very high yield potential there in that system, okay? So I think, you know, we've got all these tremendous genetic advancements and technical advancements, but the missing part is getting that soil to function to its highest level. That's what so much of the research has missed and some of the technology. We've got all this great stuff, but it's not been coupled with a truly healthy soil, a truly functioning soil. And we will have to change our management. So there's going to be some details that we'll have to work out and help producers get through. There's not going to be a single silver bullet, but there will be maybe a silver buckshot. You know, there are lots of little silver bullets, but you're going to have a good plan, a good management strategy to keep those on target. And ultimately, that's how we're going to capture the potential of that system. Okay? We can do this. We can build this system that heads towards high soil health.